I'm Martin Schein, and I'm working in GNOT Labs in Dresden for about like 6 or 5 years now. And today I want to talk about user-level networking in GNOT, to say everything that you can do between the microkernel and your web applications. So in general, GNOT is like a building block system, and so can you have a lot of building blocks, and you put them together to your individual solution. And so there are some building blocks that are for networking, and I will give an overview today. The first chapter will be a big picture about all the components, and then we will orient on them there in this picture. Through the other chapters, the first is about the drivers that we have, and then about the controlling tools, so say tools that are used as interception tools for the networking session that we have on top of the drivers. And then we speak a little bit about what front ends exist and how this is implemented. And at the end, I will give a little motivation for applications and look on applications that already exist in general. So, first to the overview. I have separated them, as said, in four layers. You have these drivers. We have the main drivers that now exist. And they support, they use the device I/O that is supported by, that is provided by the core of GNOME. And all give a generic interface, the NIC session interface. And with this NIC session interface, you can do all the controlling stuff. So you can do routing, you can do encryption and other things that you want to do, bump in a wire between two NIC sessions. And then on top of that, you have this front end layer where you adapt to your application what your application needs as backend. So let's start. I will also go a little bit into the history of the components. First, the wired NIC driver. In GNOME, we had at the first place a port of Linux, of the Linux NIC driver. Especially for the PC net cards of AMD in the year of 2009. But this was merely for the QEMU compatibility. And later it realized that we need some support for actual hardware that is built into laptops that we use. So the laptops that we use had almost all these 1000 series of Intel built in, so we needed some more support. And at this point, it was a good option to go to the GPXE project to look at this code. GPXE is a network bootloader project that is the successor of Etherpad. And it is a pretty small, slim framework. It is easy to port, and so we switched to this and had them support for the Intel network cards. In the year 2011, we discovered that the GPXE sources were a little bit inactive. So there was not much activity by the developers, and so there was the official successor of the GPXE project, the IPXE, and we took an approach to this and switched to these newer sources. So we are more up to date, and can support for new cards can be enabled easily. Okay. There's also and USB as a NIC support over USB. You can use, this is ported from the Linux sources. We use it especially for these ports here, the Exynos 5 SOC, OMAP 4 SOC, and Broadcom SOCs, because we used things like the Thunderbolt or the Ondale board, and Broadcom is the Raspberry Pi. So there you need a network over USB. Okay. We go on with the Wi-Fi driver. The Wi-Fi driver was initially a port of the Met Wi-Fi, port of Linux, and it enabled us the FRS chipsets, that especially these ones that are listed here. And yeah, over the years, it came into place that we wanted more of these Intel Wi-Fi cards to have supported, and this was enabled with the port of IVL Wi-Fi, and we took this as opportunity to port also the whole Wi-Fi stack of Linux. And the VPA supplicant, because with the Met Wi-Fi we had no protection, for instance. So, yeah, only unprotected Wi-Fi. And yeah, this was quite some work. I think it took about 6 months or so to get this monster of a code base ported and regulated. And yeah, what came out is this Wi-Fi driver component that works as follows. I will give a short overview. The Wi-Fi driver component takes an IQ and PCI session to talk with the device, of course, and then you have some ROM module that you get in, and this ROM module contains at the beginning it contains the WLAN that you want to connect to, or it contains nothing. It can be empty too. So the Wi-Fi driver then scans, of course, the WLANs that are available, and it provides to you a report. This is like a file, but it's not really the same. But it gives you in this report a list of all available Wi-Fi's, so you can connect. You can choose from these ones and this ones, and it also gives you information about signal quality, protection types, and so on. And if you have not configured yet this Wi-Fi inside the WLAN configuration, you can now put it in, and it tries to connect. So this WLAN configuration, the Wi-Fi driver always, all the time, listens to this WLAN configuration. And all the time it changes, it tries to reconnect to the Wi-Fi you configured in here. And the end product of that is the report WLAN state. In this WLAN state, you can see if you are connected and to which Wi-Fi you're connected. And yeah, I can hopefully. Yeah, I can show this here, of course. In my scenario, this is a runtime NIC, where we have these access points. Yeah. There are the access points listed for the values. And the state shows that we are successfully connected with the Fossamela on 2SA. Okay. And here we also have the BSS system. Okay. Okay, the next thing is pretty simple. It's a NIC loopback. I have not much to explain about this. It took a NIC session from, it provides a NIC session where you can put something in, and it is, it's not highly sophisticated. Okay, we go on to the controlling tools. Maybe the first thing that was in the queue was the NIC bridge. The NIC bridge implements some flavor of the proxy R protocol. And it monitors the ARP, the ARP and the DHCP that goes on the NIC sessions, and tries to get some a mapping about the clients that are connected to this. And that is like an OSI layer of research. So what you have is it has one uplink at the downside at the bottom, and multiple clients that can connect at the other side, and you can either leave it to the NIC bridge to collect this information, these relations between IP addresses and MAC addresses, or you can also configure it statically. So you can say this NIC line one has IP address so and so, and line two has IP address so and so, and the MAC addresses are allocated for each client. So it creates some virtual MAC addresses for each client. Okay, and then it forwards packets that can come from the uplink or from other clients according to their destination IP addresses. That's all. Okay, now for the NIC router. The NIC router is a little bit, it started with a pretty small set of features that we wanted to achieve in the special that we wanted to have NAT. And it ended up in implementing a whole layer 3, layer 4 routing component that now knows routing for IPv4, TCP, and UDP. It can also do NAT, of course, for TCP and UDP. And we have port forwarding for these two layer 4 protocols. And yeah, in the past we had also the problem that we wanted to do DHCP. We wanted to have DHCP for the single domains behind the NIC router. And originally the plan was to do DHCP outside of the NIC router and to do an extra component, and then we would reconfigure the NIC router. But for the first step, we thought it was nice to have this DHCP inside the NIC router, because it's not much code actually. But yeah, in the future this will maybe get outside the NIC router to an extra component. But there we would have to do an extra component that manages the reconfiguration of the NIC router. Yeah. Then the NIC router can also show you a quite big log of all the packets that go through them and all the decisions it makes. So you can have a really good insight into what's going on in your virtual networks and who is communicating with whom. But of course this is also a little bit bloated. Not all the time you want to see all the packets. But it's cool for debugging. And also it can report statistics to the outer world. So it provides a report file. In this report file you have such things like how many packets go through one domain, how many were sent, how many were received, and so on and so on. How many fails there are. And yeah. And this is a short overview over the functionality of the NIC router. So you have several domains. Each domain is like a set of rules to each domain there are these rules and the DHCP role connected. So in general, you could say that the domain is like a virtual network, a virtual subnet. And to each domain, there can connect multiple link sessions. And the uplink of the link router is not special in this. It's also only a domain. And what we have here, the only difference what we have here is that by now, the uplink is the only domain that creates a session. That is the server for a session, the client for a session, for a link session. It creates normally a link session to the driver or to whatever we get our network to, our physical subnet. So far. Okay, I can show a short example for this. Because in the scenario I'm using, there's also a link router, and it manages to manages the different applications that I have now running, and you can see here this is the configuration of the link router. We have several domains, uplink Vbox and a socket as Vbox Firefox and so on. And there are several rules, like here we have for TCP or UDP where we permit any port, in this case to go to uplink, or we want to filter out for a specific subnetwork to reroute to socket address. And so on. And we have here the DHCP server configuration of one domain. So we have the DNS server, IP system, and so on. Yeah. And you can also see here, I will use the laser pointer, that you can either go with a static configuration of the of the NIC router's IP config for the domain, or you can tell the NIC router to get its own configuration over DHCP. So it will play at the uplink DHCP client and get its own configuration this way. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now the NIC dump, this is a simple component that is bump in the wire, a real bump in the wire component for, we put it in between two NIC sessions and it shows us all the traffic that goes through. So it logs, it puts out a log for all the packet headers of these protocols that are listed here by now. And yeah, you can configure the detail of the log, and you can also switch on timestamps. Okay, Tor. Yeah, Tor, I think everyone knows Tor. It's a project that aims for anonymize TCP connections over so-called onion routing. So it uses several Tor nodes in the network. To reroute a connection and to anonymize it. And we had a port, I think 3 years ago or so, of the version, it was an earlier version first, like 0.2.4 or so. And we are not so far away from the latest version, but this is currently merely experimental. We don't test it that much. It works, as far as I can tell. I have tested it yesterday, and it comes up, and it can connect to the network and get a drink together. But there's one demo scenario you can try. It's an Eigencore run in the world repository. And this would try to fetch over URL over the Tor. So what we do in here is essentially we take the NIC router again, and we have behind one domain the fetch array, and behind the other domain there is the Tor. And we configure the fetch array domain in such a way that it can only connect to the Tor domain and to the Tor port, the 9050, I think, port. And so all the traffic of the fetch array must go over the Tor, and the Tor then has access to all the to the internet over the uplink. So you can ensure that you won't go unsecured with applications that you don't trust. Okay, next, OpenVPN. With OpenVPN, you can tunnel to virtual private networks, and this goes again bump in the wire. So you have one NIC session at the one side, and one NIC session at the other side, and it works transparently. So I don't think I have to explain this much. We have ported version 2.3.4, and this is 2.4.4. I don't know, there's some progress in work, but it's experimental. So we don't test it that much, but I know that there are guys that work with this, and it's not abandoned in this way. But you have only the bridging mode right now, so you can only do Ethernet. Okay. The front end tools. First, I will go into the stakes that we have and how they evolve. These are the IP stakes. Initially, the initial stack we had for TCP/IP was the lightweight IP stack. It was ported as lib, so you can link it against each component individually. It is accompanied by a libc plugin. So we have in Gnode this this concept of the libc that is like empty in the initial state, and you put some plugins behind it that fulfill your needs, your requirements. And the lightweight IP stack libc plugin is such a plugin that you can put behind your libc, and then you have the lightweight IP as functionality of libc. So this way you won't have to incorporate the whole libc in every component just because you need one functionality of libc. In 2013, we started experimenting a little bit with gigabit network, and then we discovered that the lightweight IP stack is not so cool when it comes to performance on gigabit network. So there was the approach to go to the TCP IP stack of Linux 2. So the TCP IP stack of Linux has the advantage that it focuses much on optimization. But the drawback of this is, of course, that it is pretty big and needs a lot of interfaces in it. And so you have a lot of porting work, a lot of maintenance work, but there's better performance. Yeah. So we have nowadays both of these stacks available. As libraries, and you can choose if you want to have a slim stack or if you want to have a stack that is good in high performance. Okay. This is a rather old picture of how it works with the stacks. You have here the NIC sessions, and on top of that you set this lightweight IP plugin or the lightweight IP lib. And then you can have, of course, here the libc on top of this, and then your application. Okay. Now to the VFS approach. I want to go a little bit into the history of VFS as it is without the stacks, because yeah, just to understand why we did things, how we do it. The first thing here is VFS is of course slightly one of the main features of Unix way that everything is a file. You can put everything into a virtual file system and then provide it as files on top. And at the other side, we have this Gnode world, where we don't want to have such thing like a global namespace and all the rights that come with it, all the privileges. We want to tailor the privileges of each component according to the requirements. And to get the best of both worlds together, we have something like the Nux runtime, one of its main features is the VFS implementation. We implemented the VFS in this, and it plays like its role is a little bit like the glue code between all the sessions that we have in Gnode and the file API for the Unix programs or for Unix applications. So at some point we discovered that it would be nice to have this VFS extracted from Nux to use it also in other applications, to have a nice generic interface to talk to, regardless of which session you want, which resource you want to speak to in Gnode. So we had this VFS lib, and we created the libc backend to accompany the VFS lib. And then we could have in each application especially tailored VFS instance. Yeah. So what you can do with this is you have like Norm showed it in the demo in the other presentation, that you have the root tree, the root VFS somewhere in this basic setup, and then you can give parts of this to other applications, and they only see these parts of the VFS in their environment, and can call it with the libc on them. Yeah, this is what we do when we go to the these shades. Yeah. Then there was the need also to do this centrally, so you could provide one VFS to multiple applications at the same time, and you can see how this works here. We have one server component that has the VFS library linked to it, and then we have multiple plugins connected to it at the back end. The log plugin at this point, for example, enables you to write to the log like it is done. This right side, and the ROM plugin, for example, you can access images of Gnode, so you can put it in as ROM modules and then see these files. And all this goes to the front end, is always the same. It's the file session, the file system session of Gnode. Yeah. So, it's obvious. was a new question at this point some years ago. We wanted to use this text that we had with the libc plugins. We wanted to use such text with multiple applications at one time. So you have one stack only, and you have multiple applications that access it. For instance, when you have not so much IP addresses or something like that, or you don't want to redo all the IP configs, so DHCP or something like that, then how would we do this? And of course, the simple approach would be at this point to introduce a new Gnode session, a socket API session, and implement a dedicated multiplexer component. But this would be pretty specialized and not so reusable, so we thought about an inspiration from the Plan 9, the Plan 9 system. And this was, why don't we integrate this whole stack into the BFS server? And so the functionality of these stacks would be provided over files to multiple clients. So the clients would have to speak only with the file session interface. And at the back end, it would be translated to network packets. Okay, this is the concept. Of course, we have something like the Linux IP plugin for the BFS library. And then you have your BFS server again and the file system session at the top of it that speaks with the applications. And yeah, how to get this? You have the LXIP plugin for the BFS creates a directory structure where you have this socket directory, and in there you have this information provided through files that comes from your DHCP. So you can read out your gateway, your netmask, your address, and so on. And you can also create new sockets by going into this TCP directory, for example, and write your read from new socket. And what you get there is then the name of the socket. And when you do this, the LXIP plugin creates a new directory with the name of the socket. And then in this directory, you have new files that are in principle the control commands that you normally need to interact with the LXIP stack. And you can write, for example, to bind or connect with the information that you want to provide, like the IP address or so you want to connect to. And then the LXIP stack would do the LXIP plugin would translate this to a reconnect in the LXIP stack. Okay. And then when you have accomplished the connection, of course, you can interact with local and remote and send data or receive data. Okay. And of course, on top of this, you can have then a file session plugin for the libc, and so you can talk, you can use in the best case unmodified applications that talk with the libc that are built upon the libc for networking. Short overview of applications that run on top of this. So we have seen already VirtualBox that runs on top of it. It runs directly on the next session to create a virtual device for its guest. And we have other components like like DOSBox for games or Grade 3 or something like that, or the Edge server like DPD that run that read with the socket API from the libc. And then we have this concept that this is routed through the FS plugin, the file system session through the FS VBS server, and so on. Okay. And of course, we have the Skype scenario that was already presented today, where we have this runtime in it, where I can start an arbitrary runtime that I want to use for my daily work. And in this runtime, I can have, for example, Xubuntu virtual box, Xubuntu guest in a virtual box, or TinyCore in a virtual box, to connect directly to a NIC session of the NIC router. Or then I initially wanted to present here to HTTP servers that I can talk to only over the TinyCore. So I can do a connection only in the TinyCore to these two, through the VFS server. But unfortunately, I had some problems with HTTP servers, so yeah, this doesn't work that well anymore. But in general, you see here, this was this NIC router. I showed the configuration some time ago, and you can have now like here this one virtual box that goes over the NIC router, connect to some websites. While we have the other virtual box with my Xubuntu, for example. And here I can also connect to websites, so it's multiplexed over the NIC router actually in the scenario that I'm using. Okay.
Some of the other guys that are more familiar.
One thing is
certainly the performance, because there I'm not entirely sure, but I think the LWIP stack doesn't implement the receive window scaling. Just there's just the patch for the send window, or the other way around, basically. So that it doesn't adapt the window sizes dynamically in one direction, which limits the performance. But in case of LWIP versus LXIP, LXIP features more socket options, so you can, there were some use cases where we needed some functionality that wasn't implemented in LWIP, and that's one of the other reasons why we choose to port a stack that is more sophisticated with its features.
And I would also add that LWIP seems to have less latency than Linux, than LXIP. But of course, if the throughput isn't as good, you know. So there's sort of trade-offs of different characteristics to get that.
You can summarize
what we're calling. Yeah, and so the first thing is it isn't implemented simply in the so we didn't put the approach to implement it in terms of the features. I think it's what you said, Joseph. We just didn't do the implementation of further features into the LWIP state. But instead,
you are not TCP IP experts in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
And tuning IP stack, we need to learn a lot of things and have a lot of experience in the chat, but don't have the resource and the time to do it. And that's why we choose, because we've got the request that all the sub ops supported we don't have, as WIP doesn't have. We choose to go this way and have two stacks. So if some customer or some client comes and wants, he can choose which stack. But there's no preference for us.
So maybe it ends up in the point that we are not so much the experts in this. The resources in the time.
Yeah.
I just wanted to repeat it for the micro.
Are you going to implement the class data with no copy between the different players?
Okay. So the question is, are we able to pass data through these different layers without a copy? And the answer is no, for more security reasons. Imagine you are in the NIC router, and you have these different packet streams that are going on in different domains. You don't want to trust the guys that use these shared memory. And essentially, it's shared memory between the client and me. And then if I'm in an untrusted domain and would say, okay, I take the shared memory and forward it to the other domain that is trusted in some way, it would be unsafe because I can take away the shared memory from the first one in the way. So, it comes with this principle of security that you can't do it without a copy.
I wonder when I got that right. That's the first thing. In the NIC bridge, you virtualize on a layer 3.
Yes.
Why you choose that instead of layer 2 virtualization when you call it a bridge, and then also have the router to do layer 3 stuff.
The question here is why do we call it a NIC bridge while it is virtualizing on layer 3? I don't know if this answers the question, but I'm referring here to the OSI layer 3, so it's an IP.
Yeah, that's the reason is why you have two ways to virtualize on an IP level.
I don't know the name. At this point, it's maybe a little bit misleading. I don't know. It's essentially a switch, and the functionality is the R proxy protocol in general. So don't let yourself be misled by the name that much.
Yeah, with time. So if we have
maybe after the
thank you.